الفكر تناجي الله في صبر وترجو رحمة تسري فعاش القلب.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أفمن شرح الله صدره للإسلام فهو على نور من ربه فويل للقاسية قلوبهم من ذكر الله أولئك في ضلال مبين. صدق الله العظيم. Dear respected brothers and sisters, we've come here and you've taken your time out to discuss about the conditions of our hearts. And to start off with, the diseased heart, or the wretched heart, the wretched soul. To understand that, we've got to understand, what does the Qur'an say about the heart? The Qur'an has used the term, it has used several terms, and one specific one that it has used is the qalb, or the qulub. Now what is the qalb? What is this? Because there are several references throughout the Quran about the qulub or about the qalb. Qalb, literally, if you look in the translations, you will see the heart. But it's not just the heart, because if you actually go to the dictionary in English, you will find that the heart is that part within the chest. If you were to tear open the chest, you will find a morsel of flesh inside there, and that literally, that piece might be called the heart. But there is something beyond that which Islam refers to. It is that place, yes, it is that place. But it's not that physical heart that we're referring to. We're referring to a place within there, within the chest, and within or around the heart that holds our emotions, holds our feelings, it holds our mindset, it holds our inclinations, it holds the way we want to, when we want to make a niyyah, when we want to make an intention, it's in there, from that part we make an intention. It holds within there khashya, or the inner fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It may sometimes have sakina, which is tranquility, when someone's really calm and collecting, or someone's feeling really, you can feel cool inside here in your heart. And we've had these feelings, when you feel really, really joyful, when you feel happy, you get a state of an emotion. Sometimes you feel that what the Qur'an has described, ضَاقَتْ بِهِمُ الْأَرْضِ, the whole earth has become constraint upon them. And the hearts become very much sort of in a mode of feeling that things are sort of closing upon it. So that is a feeling. What are these things that Allah is describing in the Quran? These are feelings inside the heart. Now if you were to literally do a heart transplant and take this heart out and put it into another body and take that heart out, put it into your body, and if you were to have, you know, a life after that with a new heart, it wouldn't mean that all your conditions would move to the other person. You would still maintain your condition. So we're talking about non-tangible feelings and emotions within a person. So, you know, this is the very same thing that a person might feel, that they feel angry, they feel sort of, they might even have a good, a high amount of thought of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, consciousness of Allah, to the extent that it saves them from sin, to the extent that makes them go towards virtuous acts. And I'll give you the references, inshallah, from the Holy Quran towards some of these things. This is the very place that a person can get the feeling that they don't want to practice the Sharia, or they don't like it, or they're not inclined towards it, or they understand it but they want to reject it, or they understand it and they love it. That is also inside there. All of these things are inside the qalb. All of these things are inside the heart. And either Allah or His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, have told us about these states. This is the very state where you will have faqaha. What is faqaha? Faqaha is when a person has knowledge of the seen, and they take that inside, and then they will start to process that with the aql and the intellect, and then come to some judgments about the unseen world and believe in those. That is called yafqahun. That is when they have a good deep understanding of the deen. And again, the heart will do that. The heart is the one that eventually makes the judgment of whether to actually lie or actually tell the truth. As in the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that a person going towards zina, he will be taken by the eye first, then the ear, then the tongue, the hand, the feet, and finally he says, قَلْبُهُ يُصَدِّقُهُ أَمْ يُكَذِّبُهُ. His heart will either accept to continue and to act that and to act upon something which Allah has forbidden and break that law, or his heart will reject that. So it's a heart that actually does that. Now, this is what we're talking about. We're talking about now the qalb or the heart. Now the heart, the state of this is always changing. This is one principle you've got to accept. Because the nature of that, the name of qalb means to change. Allah has used several words that are linked to that. He has said yataqallab. Or he has said fi taqallubihim, in the movements, in the changes. Allah said yanqalibu, they will fall back on this or move towards this. So this movement is called qalb. Now why is this heart called qalb? Is because either you're in a state of fear or you're in a state of amnesty, in a state of peace. Either your heart is in a state of tranquility or it's in a state of sort of moving about. That's where the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in a hadith, he says, "Wal ithmu ma haaka fi nafsik wa karihta an yattali' alayhi an-nas." That the nature of sin is something that will wither and move inside your chest, meaning that the heart is not content by it, you're uneasy about it, and you would not want others to find out about it. So these are the states of the mind or the inner self that a person has. Now, the movement. If we take an example of maths, now if to make you understand this quite clearly and easily, because I've only got literally about 50 minutes for my talk. If we take maths and we say zero is the state of neither you are not towards the diseased heart, nor are you towards the rectified heart. So basically you're right in the middle. You're right in the middle. Let's take that at zero. You will then find that you can take it, if you want to go towards the disease side, you can take it towards the minus. And if you want to go towards towards rectification, towards virtue and so on, you can take it towards the plus. So you've got now zero there, and then you've got plus one, then plus two, plus three and so on, all the way to about plus five, plus six, plus seven. And on this side, on the negative side, you've got from zero, you've got minus one, minus two, minus three, minus four, and all the way towards minus seven. Now, the plus side, inshallah Shaykh Abdul Hakim Murad and inshallah the other Shaykh Yaqubi that are coming, they're there to talk to you more about the plus side. And I've been given the topic about the minus side. Now, I will sort of make certain references to the plus side as we talk, but just to start off with, we all start, we all have hearts that are in the middle, and things will affect our heart condition. One of the things that will affect us immediately is the contact, that as soon as we come in contact with people. As soon as you come in contact with people, that is the first mode of effect. And if you look at the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will find that his first sunnah was to actually stay away from people. When he started from Ghar al-Hira, when he started from the cave, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the first things, حُبِّبَ إِلَيْهِ الْخَلَاءِ. One of the first things that was made lovable to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was just to stay to himself and to be in secrets, to be in a quiet place, to be away from people. This is a hadith in Bukhari. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went in that cave, and that's where he got his inspiration of the wahi, because to be in a state where a person finds that they want to be away from people, you then have the chance to have that rectification. Because to be with people, especially to be with people who have got a diseased heart themselves, or have got actions that are diseased, they will automatically have an effect on you. And the only way to make some rectification, and the only way to shift towards the right side, towards the positive side, is to use the dhikr of Allah. That is the only thing, and it's repetitive inside the hadith and inside the Quran as well. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, according to a hadith of Muslim, he says that inni la astaghfirullaha fi kulli yawm. He says that I seek forgiveness from my Allah, from my Lord, I seek forgiveness from Him 100 times a day. This is a Sahih hadith in Muslim. And he says in a separate narration in Muslim, he says, وَإِنَّهُ لَيُغَانُ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِي. What happens is that there's some kind of dust that settles from the people who are around me and the actions that they're doing. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's heart is absolutely pure and it's not going to get impure at all. And we're not going to say that it's moving towards the negative side. But what happens is, even though he's so pure, the people around him, and he's sitting with the Muslims, fine, but then the munafiq and the hypocrites are coming and meeting him. He's sitting around and the Jews are coming around him and the Christians are coming to meet him and those who are mushriks and polytheists are meeting him, and those who are ignorant and the Bedouins are meeting him, and all day he's surrounded with these people. And as he's with them, he says, لَا يُغَانُ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِي. There's a kind of a settling of a dust on my heart. So therefore, I seek forgiveness from Allah to remove this, just to polish it. It's almost like, at home, you might have a shelf, and every day, if you really like cleaning, then you really look closely, you can see there's a very, very thin layer of dust, or there's a bit of dust or something, and you just clean it. That kind of cleaning Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is referring to when he's talking about doing the istighfar. Now he's not doing it just for himself, and he doesn't necessarily have to do it. He's doing it as a teaching for us that we must also do that istighfar, to seek forgiveness from Allah. It's two things, istighfar and tawbah, to seek forgiveness from Allah and also to return back to Him. That is what tawbah is. So a state of mind of coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyway, this is in terms of the first effects. Now there is an ayah that refers to this. An ayah says in Surah Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, this is Surah number 18, verse number 28. Allah has said what to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, says, وَلَا تُطِعْ. And it's not just to him, it's to us. Primarily it's to him, but really it's for us. In Surah Al-Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us about the company that we have. And he addresses and says, وَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ أَغْفَلْنَا قَلْبَهُ عَنْ ذِكْرِنَا وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا. Do not subdue to the person. Do not fall under that person. Do not start to become obedient to that person. Do not become a person who is a follower of this person that I'm talking about now. Allah says, who? Man aghfalna qalbahu, whose heart I have made absent-minded. Whose heart is away from my remembrance. Whose heart is in forgetfulness of myself. And dhikrina. Wattaba'a hawahu, and this person follows his desires, or she follows her desires. Now, it's very specific in this ayah that Allah says, don't be in this company, because by being in this company, obviously, one will start to do what Allah says, تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Do you want to start to become the person who wants the ornament of this world? Allah says, why does He say that? He says that because of the company of these people, this is what will happen. So in contrast to that, this is, you could say, minus one. Minus one is when a person is staying in the company of ghafla, staying in the company of being absent-minded from Allah, or being absent-minded themselves. And now there are many things that can, a company is something which you don't have to physically have with a person. Today the company could be on through the TV, it could be through the computer, it could be through the satellite. Whatever that company is, because the person in their living room with the people that they're watching day in, day out, they are becoming in the company of those people. If there are people, and the ulama have very specifically said this, that if you spend your company amongst the people who continue just to laugh, then you will be in that mood. Your heart or your qalb, the state of it will be that you would want to be in their company, you will like that. So if you stay in the company of those people who are continuously going towards sin, then you will find that your inclination will be towards them. Now in contrast to this, for a plus one, in the same ayah you will see that Allah says to the Prophet ﷺ primarily, and He says to us, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَهُ وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ. Allah says, hold yourself onto these people, in the company of these people. Which people? The ones who call their Lord by day and by night, by morning and by evening. They are continuously calling Him, they are in His remembrance. يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ. Their only concern is to get the pleasure of Allah. They want the rida of Allah. And they want His pleasure. وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ. Let not your eyes stray away from them. Let not your eyes stray away from them. Then he says, تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Because if your eyes stray away from these people, then what, do you want to be affected by the ornaments of this world and so on? And the ayah finishes off by telling the Prophet ﷺ and telling us as well, not to be in the company of the one whose heart has been taken into a world of Allah's, in the loss of Allah's dhikr. Now, what is important here is that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was told specifically from this ayah that in his masjid that he must be with these people. In a hadith of Muslim, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, when you pass by the gardens of Jannah, then take most advantage of those and spend your time roaming around there. So they said, Messenger of Allah, where are these gardens of Jannah, gardens of paradise? So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in this sahih hadith, authentic hadith of Muslim, he says, the hilaqul dhikr, he says, the circles of the remembrance of God inside the masjid, these are the gardens of paradise. So what he is asked to do is, and he was told specifically, not to be distracted by all his other duties from this one thing, which is to stay in their presence, to spend time with them. Now, it's very interesting that this sahih hadith is in Muslim, about the hilaqul dhikr. It says, a circles of dhikr, of remembrance of Allah. But if you actually go to many masajid, you will not find this sunnah that is alive, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is actually being told to spend time and to stay with them and to hold himself in their company. So that is again a remedy of the one who might be in bad company. The remedy is to find good company, and specifically to find the people who are the people of not only those who can guide them in terms of knowledge, but those who can guide them in terms of the remembrance of Allah. Now please, I just want to take a minute saying this, but it's a very important part, which is that we have many people who are the people of knowledge, but they are deprived from the dhikr. And we are people of dhikr, but they're deprived of ilm. And where Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he has summed it very well, that in this religion, to be able to progress, what we're talking about, to be able to progress towards the positive, you need both the things. And he says, فَقِيهًا وَصُوفِيًا فَكُنْ لَيْسَ وَاحِدًا. He says, whether it's a jurist, a person with just knowledge, or Sufiyan, or whether it's a person of just dhikr and Sufism, or a person of spirituality, don't end up being one of them. فَإِنِّي وَاللَّهِ إِيَّاكَ أَنْجُرُ. He says, by Allah, I'm telling you that by Allah, I am advising you. أَنْصَحُ. I'm giving you advice. He says, فَذَاكَ رَجُلٌ. He says, there's this man here, who is what? Who is the faqih, who has knowledge, who can quote to you from Bukhari, from Muslim, from the Quran and so on. He can give you the knowledge. لَمْ يَذُقْ قَلْبُهُ تُقَى. His heart hasn't tasted taqwa, or the real consciousness of Allah yet. Because it's void from dhikr, it's void from the remembrance of Allah, an abundance remembrance of Allah. So he says, look at this man, the one who's the faqih, he has got specific knowledge and specialist knowledge, but his heart is something that hasn't tasted taqwa. وَذَاكَ جَهُولٌ وَكَيْفَ ذُو الْجَهْلِ يَصْلُحُ. He says, the other one who's a spiritual person, the Sufi, the whatever you want to call them, of dhikr, an abundance of dhikr, but they don't have the real knowledge of Islam, he says, he is an ignorant person, and how can an ignorant person find the pathway? So what we are told to do is, with our knowledge, we are supposed to have dhikr. That's why Allah says in the Holy Quran, He says, Fas'alu, when He tells us to go and ask somebody about the religion, instead of saying, Fas'alu ahla al-ilmi in kuntum la ta'alamun, ask the people of knowledge if you don't know, He says, Fas'alu ahla dhikri, ask the people of dhikr, the people of remembrance, if you do not know. Why? Because
he's not just saying they're people of dhikr and not people of ilm. He's saying that Allah's given the priority to the dhikr inside them over their ilm. He's given the priority of the remembrance of God over their knowledge. So he says, go to the people who are the people of my remembrance, so that you may get a correct fatwa, a correct answer to the question that you have. Nevertheless, this was minus one, which is ghafla. Ghafla is absent-mindedness, and staying in the company of those people will only take a person minus one. Now what happens then is, a person might then sin. This is minus two. The second station, or the second part of the heart being diseased, is to move from minus one to minus two. And what is that? That is when a heart has got ithm. Now what is ithm? Ithm, simply if you look in the translations, it will tell you that it is a sin. But if you look into the lugha, into the lexicon, you will find that it says that ithm is something which a person is carrying with themselves. They're carrying with themselves, and what he's doing to them is that it's slowing them down. So it's something you've got with you that's slowing you down. Now if you're in a race, you don't want bean bags to be tied around you. Allah says, "Now, sabiqu ila al-khayrat bi-idhnillah." Come, race one another towards the khayrat, towards the good that I have kept, towards virtue and so on. But a person who's got bags around them, tied to their legs, tied to their ankles, they're going to be moving, but they're going to be moving slowly, and you know, they're not going to be moving that fast. Now, there's an ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah. This is Surah number 2, verse number 283. Allah talks about the heart that is sinful. So He says, فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ قَلْبُ. The heart now is sinful, or the heart now is carrying something which is slowing them down. Now it's interesting to look at that verse. What is Allah talking about here? Why is it that they're sinful, and what is that slowing them down? In that part of the verse, you will see in verse number 282 and 283, Allah is talking about transactions. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, or you believe. إِذَا تَدَيَّنْتُمْ بِدَيْنٍ, when you're making transactions, then start writing it down. And He continues how to write it down, what kind of witnesses you should have, and so on and so forth. Until He gets to the part, He says, okay, if you haven't got anything written down, then you can have a verbal agreement between yourselves if you're making a transaction. If you trust each other, that's fine. But then Allah says, وَلَا تَكْتُمْ, He says, don't hide a witness or a witnessing statement when it comes to you telling the truth. And Allah says, وَمَنْ يَكْتُمْهَا, whoever will hide the truth and not mention the witness, that you know, there was a barter, there was a transaction, and they're not, you know, they're at this moment now, they were there, they were a witness, or they know of a witness, you know, a person who witnessed this transaction, and they're just not mentioning anything. Now, they're not lying, this is the thing, they're not lying, but they're not telling the truth. To lie is a clear major sin. But not tell the truth is all, when you need to tell the truth, is also sinful. But obviously the two things are different, because the one who blatantly lies is more of a criminal than the one who just hides the truth and ends up, you know, not being part of whatever is going on. But Allah says that whoever does this, فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ قَلْبُ, his heart is something that is now sinful. Now, this part, if you look in another part of the Quran, you will find that there is another part to this, which is when a person sins, they will now become sinful in a repetitive manner. This is now going to be minus three. So where's this reference? This reference is in the Quran. This is, and minus three should be looked at as specifically with the heart not only becoming burdensome or slow, but now you're looking at the heart becoming rusty. The term rusty is being used. This is in the Holy Quran, in Surah number 83, Mutaffifin, verse number 14, where Allah says, now He's going to another state now. He's saying that, He says, قَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. He says that these people, they have got rust on their hearts because of the actions that they've done. They've committed continuously. So when a person has sinned, and they've sinned again, and they've sinned again, and they've sinned again, Allah says just before that ayah, He says, مُعْتَدٍ أَثِيمٍ. They have started to go beyond my barriers, my hudud, or my lines that I've told them not to cross. They've crossed them several times. And Athim, they are now becoming in a sinful nature. Allah says now they have started to get rust on their hearts. This is a natural process that will take place if anyone continues to become sinful. Obviously, what is the way out? The way out is to do dhikr. There's an interesting hadith in Muslim where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that when a person commits a sin, then there is an angel that will throw and spot the heart. Put onto the heart what? A black dot. They will just throw it onto the heart. And when a person sins again, they will do the same thing. When a person sins again, they will do the same thing. Until the heart will start to become black. Now we're not talking about literal heart again here. We're talking about there's a section inside there spiritually. That is what's happening. But he says in the same hadith that if a person does a good deed, then nukitat bihi nukta bayda. The angel will then put a dot onto the heart, a spot onto that is white. And it starts to then move from black to, you can imagine, dark grey or grey, and then slowly towards light white or something, and then, you know, sparkling bright white. So you've got this transaction that all of us are going through, because either we're sinning and we're moving towards the minus, or we're doing virtuous acts, so therefore we're moving towards the plus. But anyone who's in -3 will have to move to -2, and then come to -1, and then come to 0, and then come to +1, then +2, and so on. So if any one of us is not really feeling like the sweetness of Iman, we're not feeling an inclination towards something, see, what you've got to understand is, for these things you've got to be in the plus, for to feel a good feeling towards Allah, towards dhikr, towards the Quran, towards tilawah, and so on. A person has to be in way into the plus. Now, here Allah says that the kalla bal rana ala qulub, they've got rust on their hearts. So the hadith in Tirmidhi, where Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that everything has a detergent, everything that has detergent. He says that metal gets corroded with water because it will be rusty, but he says it has got a way of, you know, you've got a way of taking that rust off. And he says that the heart gets corroded also. And he says to get the corrosion off the heart, to get that rust off the heart, he says, dhikrullah. He says that the detergent of the heart is the remembrance of Allah. The ulama have said that this ithm is when a person is looking at khair and shar. They're looking at good and they're looking at evil, but they really are becoming blind from what is wrong and what is right. Now this ayah is very interesting in Surah Mutaffifin, because what's happening here is not just about hiding the truth. Here, the person is in the marketplace and is literally cheating. So the ayah, the surah starts off with وَيْلُ لِلْمُطَفِّفِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا اكْتَالُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ يَسْتَوْفُونَ. So in the marketplace, and when somebody is, when they want something of someone, they want it in full amounts. They want the full money. But when they're giving something back to them as a product, they're giving a product that is faulty or slightly faulty, but they're hiding it. Or they're making a measurement. So for example, 5 kilos of something, they're measuring it, but they're basically just flicking something up with their thumb, just slightly holding it high so that, you know, it shows that it's 5 kilos, but it's really not 5 kilos. So you have this person that is actually cheating deliberately in the market, and therefore they've got now rust on their hearts. Now this was -3. If the person, in whatever deeds that they're doing, they are not only continue in this manner, what will happen is that they will start to go towards qaswa. They will now start to go towards a heart that is becoming hard. Now, I said to you that -1, which is ghafla, which is something which a person is in an absent-minded state. Allah says, you know, the opposite to that is to be in a good company. When a person is of -2 and they've got a sinful heart, the opposite of that is to start speaking the truth. The opposite of that is to be open and honest. And you look in that ayah of Surah Baqarah, you will find that Allah talks about good dealings of men who are absolutely honest and they want to be fair in their trade. Being fair, being honest, having that adl and justice, this is the opposite. This is like being +2. Having that -3 of ran, or having rust on their hearts, if you look into the Quran, you will find that what Allah talks about in opposite to that, in that same surah, in Surah Mutaffifin, he talks about the people with rust. He says they're fujjar. They're people who are committing sins on a regular basis. But then he calls their opposite people abrar, the people of virtue. And if you want to see virtue, you turn to Surah Baqarah in the Holy Quran, in the second surah. You will find that Allah talks about a number of virtues that a person can do. And this would be plus three. If a person wants to be in the plus three, they would naturally be wanting to do some of these deeds. Allah says that in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 177. Allah says, لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبِلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ Allah says, what is virtue? Virtue is مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ One who believes in Allah, وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ Believes in the last day, وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ The angels, وَالْكِتَابِ The books, وَالنَّبِيِّينَ The prophets, وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ And out of the love of God they give wealth. ذَوِي الْقُرْبَى to their close ones, وَالْيَتَامَى to the orphans, وَالْمَسَاكِينَ to those who need it, وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ to the traveler, وَالسَّائِلِينَ those who come to ask them, وَفِي الرِّقَابِ those who need to be freed as slaves, وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ they're performing the salah, وَآتَ الزَّكَاةَ they're giving the zakah, وَالْمُوفُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ See, this is the opposite. They will make sure that they are keeping their promise. So on the opposite side, in minus three, you've got people who are breaking promises, who are not really looking after the promises. Here you've got people who are keeping their promises. إِذَا عَهَدُوا when they make it. وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ There are people who will generally have sabr or patience when it comes to afflictions, when it comes to even good moments. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا These people are truthful ones. Those were liars on the opposite side. Minus three were liars. Plus three are truthful people. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ مُتَّقُونَ Allah says, these are the people of taqwa. These are the people who have my consciousness. Whereas those people are the people who are, you know, in a sinful sort of state and nature. Now we come to minus four, which is qaswa. Now qaswa is when the heart has got rust and then the person continues to be sinful and the heart then becomes hard. Now the reference for this you will find in a few places of the Quran. One of the places is in Surah Al-Hadid, which is the 57th surah of the Holy Quran. And you look at verse number 15, verse number 16 and so on. Verse number 16, you will find that Allah says that فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدْ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ The hearts became hard and now they started to long to stay on this earth. They wanted their lives to be longer. And in separate parts of the Quran, you will see reference like رَضُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا They are completely pleased with being in this world. They like to be here. They are attached to this world. They have love for this world. Now love of this world is actually a disease. حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا Love of this world is actually a disease. And obviously the opposite of this would be the love of the Akhirah. The opposite of this also is in this part of the Quran, Surah Al-Hadid, where Allah says, أَلَمْ يَأْنِنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ Allah says, hasn't the time come for those who have believed that their hearts become humble, hearts become inclined to, hearts become those that are that accept the Quran for what? لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ They accept the remembrance of Allah. They accept whatever has been revealed to them. Now this is something that the hearts are always sort of thinking about deeply inside. So this is the opposite. This is plus four. But minus four is qaswa. Allah explained that in another part of the Holy Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah. He says, ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُ مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ Then their hearts became hard. Now these people whose hearts are hard in here, In the people who had minus three or ran, they were called fujjar. They were people who were sinful. These people who are called kathir minhum fasiqun. Allah says most of them, they are those fasiqs. Now fasiq is a person who has not only gone beyond the limits, but they are continuous. You know, continuously they are breaking the laws of God. When it comes to even fasiq is another reference in Surah Baqarah. You will find Allah says yanquduna ahdallahi min ba'di mithaqihim. They will even break the law of God after they've actually made the covenant with Allah. And another part in the Surah Al-Baqarah where Allah makes a reference is to those Jewish people in the past who had known the truth, understood the truth of the Torah, knew that they're supposed to copy it correctly, but they started to hide certain parts when they copied it. So Allah says, أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا لَكُمْ وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ يُحَرِّفُونَهُ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا عَقَلُوهُ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ They change deliberately the nuzul when it comes to the revelation of God. They don't just accept the hearts are not you know, affirming to this, but they want to just get rid of certain parts of the Torah. So what they did is, they started to make, you know, make copies of new Torah, but they left certain parts of the old Torah out. And they left certain parts, they twisted it, they turned it, يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَمْ مَوَاضِعِ. And Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَا قُلُوبَهُمْ قَاسِيَةً. I made their hearts become hard. Because now you're not dealing with just the sin with people, you're dealing with the sin with the revelation of God. Or you're dealing with a major sin that is beyond what normal people do. Now, it's interesting that in both parts, here you've got خَشَى قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ, that they are becoming inclined towards the revelation of what is there, and they're becoming humble in front of it. And the others are misconstruing, sort of changing, deliberately altering the words of God. And Allah says their hearts are hard. Now, the opposite obviously of this is خُشُوع. Plus, four will be those people who have khushu. Now who are the people of khushu? Allah says, الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ وَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Those who have full conviction that they are going to meet their Lord on the Day of Judgment. Now, this is the opposite. Plus four will be those people who in their salah, for example, they've got khushu. In their salah, within their salah, they have got their minds, their hearts. Their hearts are towards Allah. Allah says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those whose hearts are completely humble and submitted to Allah. Their minds are to Allah, thinking of Allah when they're actually in their salah. Now that was minus four. If you go to minus five, there is a blindness of the heart. And Allah talks about that in the Holy Quran, in the 17th part of the Holy Quran, in Suratul Hajj, 22nd Surah, verse number 46. Allah says that the eyes really don't get blind. The real thing that is getting blind is the heart. The real thing that gets blind is the heart. He said, وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَى الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. Those hearts there, they're becoming absolutely blind to my message. Because now you have gone so far in sinning and objecting or doing something wrong and rejecting the message, that now you actually become blind to the truth. Now what is blindness? Blindness is that the truth is there and you don't see it. Blindness, a blind man would not be able to see what is there in front of him right now, whether it was a door or whether it was something else, a wall, until he actually puts his stick there and then he makes out what is in front of him. The same way with these people with blind hearts. But they've still got remedy. This is the thing. This is now minus five, but they've got remedy. They've got opportunity for remedy. What is the opportunity for remedy? In that same ayah, in verse number 46 of surah number 22, Allah says, أَفَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَتَكُونَ لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ يَعْقِلُونَ بِهَا. Why don't they traverse the earth, travel on the earth? Why don't they bring themselves out of this community, start seeing new things out there, start seeing my signs out there, and maybe they may get hearts that will start to, you know, to understand, to use the intellect correctly. This is in the same verse. So there is still scope for these people to make a reversal. And what you find opposite to this, in plus five are those people who are basira. Basira is something where a person has an insight. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this, because what happens is on this side, the shaitan probably doesn't even need to do anything in minus five. They're blind to the truth, they're so backward on what they're doing. But on the other side, it's so difficult for the shaitan to do something. And if you look in Suratul A'raf, the seventh surah of the Quran, and you look in verse number 201. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا, those who have got taqwa and those who got my consciousness, إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ طَائِفٌ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ, when a whole group of devils come to them and try to afflict them, تَذَكَّرُوا, they get a remembrance, فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ, and then they have an insight into their condition. They are able to protect themselves from the influence of the shaitan. They have basira, they have an inner sight of what they need to do at that time. So for example, going straight towards the dhikr of Allah and so on, or doing something that the shaitan will not be able to overpower them. Now when you go from minus five now towards minus six, you have something. Now what happens is they're not just blind, but Allah will actually put a lid onto the heart. There is actually a lid onto the heart. It's called akinna or kin. Now akinna, they say, is ghita, or they say in Arabic, which is a lid. So if you've got a pot and you want to cover the pot, you just put a lid on it so there's nothing else going inside there. Now, Allah says in the Holy Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ أَكِنَّةً أَنْ يَفْقَهُوهُ. Allah says in Surah number 6, verse number 25, that I then put a lid onto their hearts, that they do not get the message, or they now will not be able to have that deep understanding of the religion. Now, opposite to this, in plus 6, you will find that Allah is always talking about faqaha. He's talking about deep understanding. Now, this is a very clear example is of Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, whom Allah, and in contrast to that, Abu Jahl. Now, Abu Jahl was clearly on akinna. You know, they said themselves, "Qulubuna ghulfa," our hearts don't accept this. We've got some kind of barrier between this and the message. And in Surah An'am, which is the sixth surah, verse number 122, you'll see Allah says, "Awman kana maytan fa ahyanahu wa ja'alna lahu nura." Allah says, "The one who was dead, then I gave him life and I put him onto a nur or a light, which is knowledge, and he walks between people with this light. Is he the same with the one who is in darknesses? Kama mathaluhu fi dhulumati laysa bi kharijin minha." He's not going to come out of there. Now this is the contrast of the true two of plus 6 and minus 6. Whereas the minus 6, they have got a lid onto their hearts. So the now it's actually becoming secure away from the truth. Whereas plus 6, you've got sharh. You've got an opening where Allah says, فَمَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ أَنْ يَهْدِيَهُ يَشْرَحْ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. Whosoever Allah wants, they will, he will open his heart towards Islam. And this is specifically, they say, was revealed for the condition of Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And you find in Surah Az-Zumar, in the 39th surah of the Holy Quran, very interesting ayah, Allah says, أَفَمَنْ شَرَحَ اللَّهُ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. What about the one whose heart Allah has opened to Islam and he is on some knowledge from his Lord? So this is, now plus 6 is when they get specific knowledge from Allah. Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu clearly had this. He had a knowledge which most common people didn't have. And Allah says after that he says, فَوَيْلُ لِلْقَاسِيَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Allah, woe to the ones whose hearts have become hard from my remembrance. Again, we're reminded that the remembrance of Allah is the thing that will shift us from the negative to the positive. So that is to do, and again, every time Allah mentions akinna or kin in minus six, He always says, أَن يَفْقَهُوهُ. They don't have the faqaha, or they don't have that deep understanding of Islam. Now, as I said earlier, the ulama have said that either faqaha or that understanding, deep understanding, is when a person looks at the shahid, when they look at what is present and they're able to understand the ghaib, they're able to understand the unseen world and makes true conviction about that. Or they say it's a deep understanding of the sharia. So, and there's a hadith of Bukhari that is explained, this is explained by it, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he talks about people in Jahala and they say, all of you, the best, he says, khiyarukum, the best of you in the days of ignorance, khiyarukum fil jahiliyyah, khiyarukum fil Islam. He says, the best of you in the ignorant days can be the best in Islam to either faquhu, when they get to this stage of deep understanding of Islam. Now the last stage, there's two words used for it in the Quran, which is minus 7, which is tab' or khatm. Tab' is a seal that is sealed off. Now with the last one, akinna, there's a lid. Now a lid, you can pull it back off, and you can still put something else inside there. But khatm is when it's completely sealed around. And Allah has said in the beginning of the Quran, He says in Surah Baqarah, verse number 7, He says, "He says, Khatam Allahu ala qulubihim." Allah has sealed their hearts. Wa ala sam'ihim, the seal their hearing. Wa ala absarihim ghishawa, on their eyes there is a veil, casted veil. What is Allah talking? Allah saying, "Inna alladhina kafar." These people, they are those people who've gone so far. سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ. It is the same. أَنْذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنْذِرُهُمْ. Oh Prophet, if you warn them, or whether you don't warn them, لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. These people are not going to believe. This is the people of Khatm, who have completely sealed themselves, have had their hearts sealed. Why? As a result of what they've done. Now the opposite to this, you will find that, you know, Allah said in plus 6, He has called a sharh. Allah has opened the heart fully. And you will find that opposite to this as well, and to some of the other things that Allah has said, tab'a. Tab'a is another word. In the Holy Quran, in the 14th juz, in surah number 16, verse number 108, you will find Allah says, "Taba Allahu ala qulubihim wa sam'ihim wa absarihim." Their hearts have been closed off. They've been sealed off. And opposite to this, if you just look two ayats before that, Allah says, "Wa qalbuhum mutma'innun bil iman." Allah says, there's not only a sharah, there's not only an opening, walakin man sharaha. Allah has not only opened their hearts to Islam, but Allah has made their hearts completely content with their iman. They don't need any conviction at all with their deen and with their belief in Islam. So Allah says, they have got this qalbuhum mutma'innum, their heart is absolutely with itminan. And this is where Ibrahim alayhi salam, he had said to Allah, "Oh Allah, show me how you will bring the dead back to life again." Allah says, "Why are you saying this, Ibrahim? Awalam tu'min, do you not believe?" He said, "No, walakin liyatma'inna qalbi." So that I can get to the last stage of that plus seven, to that final thing, that when you've seen the mushahada, when you've gone to that stage where you've had so much of overwhelming of, inshallah the other shuyukh will talk about this, then you get to the stage where there is absolutely no rage, or there is no conflict in the heart at all. And if you look in the same Surah Baqarah, in the beginning where Allah talks about the khatam, He talks about the people of the best of the muttaqin. He gives them a word which He does not give except a few other times. The Quran, He says, وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. They have complete conviction in the Akhirah, in the next life. It's يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. Okay, that's fine. They're praying, they're believing this revelation, they're giving and so on. They are on guidance. هُدًى مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ مُفْلِحُونَ. They have got success. But a very, very special thing He says about them is لَا رَيْبَ فِي هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. There's absolutely no doubt. No doubt for these people inside it. And they are the people who have been guided because they have got that taqwa. This taqwa which has got iqan, which has got that full conviction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give all of us the tawfiq to, if we are in the darkness or any of these minuses that I've mentioned, may Allah take us towards the plus. May Allah make us the people of virtue. May Allah give us that enlightening, and may He open our hearts. JazakumAllahu khairu wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alameen.